from the Heidelberg Catechism. We read together Lord's Day 10. What do you understand by the providence of God? God's providence is his almighty and ever-present power, whereby as with his hand he still upholds heaven and earth and all creatures, and so governs them that leaf and blade, rain and drought, fruitful and barren years, food and drink, health and sickness, riches and poverty, indeed all things come to us not by chance, but by his fatherly hand. What does it benefit us to know that God has created all things and still upholds them by his providence? We can be patient in adversity, thankful in prosperity, and with a view to the future, we can have a firm confidence in our faithful God and Father that no creature shall separate us from his love. For all creatures are so completely in his hand that without his will, they cannot so much as move. Beloved congregation of our Lord Jesus Christ, have you seen pictures of the devastation brought about by forest fires? Vast tracts of land with spindly remains of trees charred and blackened. Smoldering foundations where people's homes have gone up in smoke. Can you imagine the loss suffered by having your home and things precious to you burned up by fire? In Lord's Day 10, we confess that God's providence is his almighty and ever-present power, whereby, as with his hand, he still upholds heaven and earth and all creatures, and so governs them that leaf and blade, rain and drought, riches and poverty come to us not by chance, but by his fatherly hand. If you consider the effects of drought in various countries in Africa, have you seen video of productive cropland that's turned to dust, blown around by the wind? Do images of children with spindly arms and legs, dying from a lack of food, touch you in any way? Can you imagine the hopelessness of not being able to provide food for your children? In Lord's Day 10, we confess that God governs all things so that fruitful and barren years, food and drink come to us, not by chance, but by his fatherly hand. You ever suffered a serious accident or being diagnosed with a debilitating illness? Are you or one of your loved ones confronted by ongoing struggles and hardships that result from the breakdown of the body or of the mind? We experience the piercing pain and overwhelming grief that results from losing a loved one. In Lord's Day 10, we confess that God is also in charge of health and sickness, that also these things come to us not by chance, but by God's fatherly hand. The doctrine of God's providence is often a difficult teaching for us. It raises certain fundamental questions. Is God good? If God is truly a good God, why does he allow evil to flourish? If God genuinely loves his children, why does he allow us to suffer? When we're confronted with illness and disease, with accidents, with economic hardships, relationship difficulties, stress, anxiety, depression, and even death, it often raises serious questions about God's care for us. We often think we could do a much better job than God does in ordering and arranging what happens in our lives. While the doctrine of God's providence is often a difficult one for us to accept, It's ultimately a supremely comforting teaching. Our Almighty God does not randomly send trouble upon us for no reason. He does not allow us to suffer, to drive us away from Him. God has purpose in how and why He directs our lives. He controls things in such a way that even adversity is turned to our good. We may not always see or understand how God is at work in our lives, and yet we're called to trust in His providential care for us. I preach to you God's word under the following theme: by His mighty hand, God rules over this world for the benefit of His people. We'll consider our struggle with God's providential rule and God's assurance that no creature shall separate us from His love. In Lord's Day 10, we confess that God's providence is His almighty power, whereby, as with His hand, He still upholds heaven and earth and all creatures, and so governs them that nothing comes to us by chance, but by His fatherly hand. Please note the double reference to God's hand. The Bible often speaks about God's powerful right hand. It's a symbol of God's power and might. When the Lord drowned Pharaoh and his armies in the Red Sea, His people praised Him in song, singing, "Your right hand, O Lord, glorious in power. Your right hand, O Lord, shatters the enemy." In Psalm 44, the psalmist confesses that Israel did not conquer the promised land by its military might. He says, "For not by their own sword did they win the land, nor did their own arm save them. But Your right hand and Your arm and the light of Your face, for You delighted in them." It's by God's hand that He delivered Israel through the Red Sea. It's by His right hand that He brought them into the promised land. God's hand is a symbol for His sovereign rule over all things. We, beloved, are happy to be ruled by God's almighty hand. We draw great assurance from the fact that our God holds this whole world in His hands. It's of supreme comfort to us when Jesus tells us, "Not even a hair can fall from our head without our Father's will." When life is going for us, our catechism encourages us to be thankful. It teaches us to be thankful to God, from whom all blessings flow. We're not always good at that. We tend to take credit for the good things happening in our lives, attributing these things to our smarts or to our own hard work. But the Bible teaches that all blessings come from God's hand, that we are to thank and praise Him for them. Yet life doesn't always go well. It's in times of hardships and struggles that we tend to question God's providence. If God is sovereign, then why do bad things happen to us? Why do we face great adversity in our lives? Why do we at times have to struggle and suffer so much? There's times that the pressures of life come crashing down on us, and we feel like we can hardly breathe. There's times when we cry out, as David did, "How long, O Lord, will You forget me forever? How long will You hide Your face from me?" There's times and situations where God's people may even begin to despair of life itself. Times like in Psalm 88, when we, like the psalmist, feel like the darkness has become our closest friend. And then, beloved, we ask questions. We try to figure out what's happening in our lives. But even the keenest minds cannot fully explain God's ways with us. We ask, why do bad things happen to me when I'm doing my best to love and serve God in my life? We wonder, is God truly a good God? If he is, then why does he allow evil to flourish? Why does my gracious Father allow so much misery in my life? When considering these questions, we need to remember that God made the world good. Sin and all the misery that flows from sin came as a result of our fall into sin. Because of our sin, God's curse came on mankind and on his beautiful creation. Through the fall, we became subject to sickness and death, and creation itself is groaning like a woman in childbirth. So we confess in Article 13 of the Belgian Confession that God is not the author of the sins which are committed, nor can he be charged with them. While we may at times question the hardships and the suffering that comes upon us in this life, we cannot blame God for the things we brought into this world. But still, we struggle with the Bible's teaching that God rules over all things by his fatherly hand. How do you go forward in life when calamity has come upon you? What do you do when the questions you ask have no answers? Psalm 77 teaches us something about that. While the context of the psalm is not explicitly stated, most connect this psalm with what God's people experienced in the Babylonian captivity. Israel was the covenant people of God. They were living in the inheritance given them by God himself. The trauma that they went through was great. The Babylonians carried off Jerusalem's riches, including some of the temple articles. Many of God's people were killed in warfare, and of those who remained, the best and brightest were taken into captivity. After the first two deportations, when King Zedekiah still refused to submit, the Babylonians destroyed Jerusalem and demolished the temple. Israel was completely subjugated. The overthrow of Judah involved deportation, a violent uprooting of God's people to a faraway land. It's a process from which no nation had ever recovered. Yet God's people had received many rich promises from the Lord. Were these promises canceled? Did the Lord no longer love his people? The Babylonians taunted the Jews with the superiority of their gods. God's people didn't understand how the Lord had allowed their defeat. So what did they do? They prayed. Asaph records for us what they prayed. He provides a roadmap of the journey God's people went on, trying to reconcile their devastating circumstances with what they knew about God's sovereign rule over them. Psalm 77 begins with an outpouring of grief. Asaph says, I cry aloud to God, and he will hear me. This, beloved, is a faith response. God's people had been dealt a devastating blow. They were God's people, living in God's land. But somehow the Lord allowed their enemies to subjugate and exile them. Jerusalem's walls were broken down. The temple was utterly destroyed. Even though God's people didn't understand what was happening to them and why God allowed this, they still turned to God in prayer. They poured out their hearts to him. Asaph says, in the day of trouble, I seek the Lord. In the night, my hand is stretched out without wearying. Beloved, when we face trouble and distress, do we turn to God? Do we cry out to Him? Do we recognize that God is the one who can truly help us? Sometimes that's really hard for us to do. But the Lord says, call on me in the day of trouble, and I will deliver you. Turning to God is always the right thing to do when we're in trouble. Yet even though the psalmist turned to God, he did not immediately relieve his distress. Asaph says, my soul refuses to be comforted. We see that he underwent a deep spiritual struggle. God did not seem at all comforting to him. Remembering God caused him to moan. Meditating caused his spirit to faint. The psalmist was in such distress he couldn't even sleep. He says, you hold my eyelids open. I'm so troubled, I cannot even speak. What we see here, beloved, is a normal human response to deep suffering. We cry. We moan. We cannot sleep. We feel like there's nothing that will ever provide comfort again. Suffering often involves a whole body response. It affects our emotions. It clouds our thinking. It overwhelms us. We can't begin to imagine what normal life was like because our world has been completely rocked. We don't know where to go or what to do. Life circumstances have devastated us. How do you respond to adversity in your life, beloved? I'm sure that like Asaph and the exiled Israelites, there may be times when we struggle deeply with what's happened in our lives. At times, life circumstances overwhelm us, and we can ask a lot of questions and not receive much clarity in answering them. In such circumstances, we need to be careful not to blame God or find fault with Him. God's ways are higher than our ways, and His thoughts than our thoughts. In Romans 9:20, Paul reminds us of who we are in relation to the Almighty Ruler of heaven and earth. He says, but who are you, O man, to answer back to God? Well, what does molded say to its molder? Why have you made me like this? Has the potter no right over the clay? When dealing with the struggles and sorrows of life, we need a lot of humility. We need to learn to trust that God knows what He's doing in our lives. It brings us to our second point. You know, we'll consider God's assurance that no creature shall separate us from His love. After responding emotionally with what happened to him, the psalmist starts puzzling through God's role in his adversity. He wants to try and make sense of something he cannot understand. He looks back in his life and remembers how he used to praise God. Asaph says, let me remember my song in the night. Let me meditate in my heart. Asaph shows us how to overcome the personal doubts and fears we may have when we're confused by what God's doing in our lives. He considers the days of old, the years of long ago. He meditates on the Lord's dealings with His people so he can find comfort and assurance in God's care over his life once more. Asaph speaks about how his spirit within him made a diligent search. And he asks himself a series of hard questions. The type of questions we ask when we simply cannot understand God's ways with us. He asks, will the Lord spurn forever and never again be favorable? Has His steadfast love forever ceased? Are his promises at an end for all time? Has God forgotten to be gracious? Has he in anger shut up compassion? Asaph accepts that it seems like God has turned his face away from him and away from God's people. But would this last? Would God utterly forsake him forevermore? In verse 10, Asaph comes to a turning point in the midst of his devastation and despair. He says, I will appeal to this, to the years of the right hand of the Most High. What's he saying? God's right hand is a reference to God's providential hand, to the power by which he rules over all things. Asaph is looking to see how the Most High God has exercised his right hand over the years. He says, I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your wonders of old. Remembering is important. It's something our kids at ICS are being taught in their school theme this year. It's when we remember what God has done in the past that we again gain confidence about how he will deal with us in the future. Asaph ponders on God's works and meditates on his mighty deeds. The first thing he concludes is, your way, O God, is holy. What God is like our God? Despite the terrible sufferings he's endured and the hardships that he still experiences, Asaph is not blaming God anymore. He confesses, you are a God who works wonders. You have made known your might among the peoples. Asaph meditates on the Lord's wondrous redemption of his people from Egypt. God acted with great power to save his people. After letting the Israelites go, Pharaoh decides to pursue them. They're caught with the Red Sea in front of them and Pharaoh and his chariots and horsemen behind them. They were stuck. They had nowhere to go. Yet God opened the way of salvation by dividing the waters of the Red Sea and creating a corridor between two walls of water. Asaph confesses, your way was through the sea, your path through the great waters, yet your footprints were unseen. The footprints of the Lord through the Red Sea are unseen. No archaeologist will ever find any trace of them. But God's people knew that it was the Lord who led them through the sea, who drowned Pharaoh and his armies in the midst of it. And thus he provided a great deliverance for his people. In the same way, the footprints of the Lord through history cannot always be traced. God's hand is there, guiding and directing our lives, leading us forward on the way of salvation. But often it's not until much later, and perhaps not until we meet with him in eternity, that we will understand God's ways and purposes in our lives. Yet adversity does play an important role in our lives, beloved. On one of his missionary journeys, Paul encouraged the Christians in Lystra, Iconium, and Antioch to continue in the faith, telling them that through many tribulations, we must enter the kingdom of God. James wrote to his readers about how they would meet trials of various kinds and how they'd experience the testing of their faith. Paul writes about this in Romans 8, 28 and 29. He says, and we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. For those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son. in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. In these verses, the Lord first identifies the people he has in view. They are those who love the Lord, those who are called according to his purpose. And what is God's purpose for us? That we might be conformed to the image of his Son. So we see that God says he is at work in the lives of those who love him. He is working to conform us more and more so that we might image Christ. That's the good that God is working for us. So how does God bring that about? Are we going to learn and grow and mature in the faith simply by enjoying a good life here on earth? Isn't it true, beloved, that most of our spiritual growth occurs from what we learn through the struggles and the sorrows of life? Does a life focused on the pursuit of money and possessions bring you close to God? If God grants you your every desire, a beautiful home to live in, more money than you could ever spend, a strong marriage and healthy children, a trouble-free passage through life, would you truly seek him and find your hope and salvation in him? Isn't it true, beloved, that it's by undergoing sickness and pain, financial hardships and relationship difficulties that we learn to trust and depend on God? Isn't it the hardships and the sorrows of life that drive us to find comfort and hope in the Lord? God has a purpose behind the adversity he allows us to suffer. Peter writes that we are grieved by various trials so that our faith may be proved genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. He compares our faith to gold being refined in the fire. In ancient times, gold was put into a hot fire so that all the alloys could be burned out of it. Yet the fire had to be at the right temperature. If it was too hot, the gold itself would be destroyed. The goal was to refine it, so you were left with 24-karat gold. God is busy in our lives, refining us. At times, he allows us to undergo trials and sorrows. God doesn't do this to be mean or to give us a hard time. He doesn't give us more than we can bear, even though at times it sure feels like it. God uses suffering to strengthen and purify our faith and trust in him. The same God who predestined us to be his children and who called us to faith is the God who has promised to justify us and glorify us. He is leading us on a pathway to everlasting life. Beloved, when you face hard struggles in your life, when you simply do not understand God's ways with you, you need to look to the Lord Jesus Christ. During his life on earth, he struggled immensely with God's plan for his life. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he was in such agony at the pathway God had ordained for him that his sweat became like great drops of blood falling on the ground. While hanging on the cross, Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" We know why Christ had to suffer and die that accursed death on the cross. It was to redeem us, to save us from our sins. It was to assure us that there is a future for us with God. Beloved, if your Savior was willing to endure the agony and the shame of the cross to purchase you for himself, I should say that again. Your Savior was willing to endure the agony and shame of the cross to purchase you from self. It's through his sacrificial death that God has adopted us as his children. By this we know love, that he laid down his life for us. Do you understand God's love for you? Do you see how he was willing to send his dearly loved Son to suffer for your sake? Does that not give you confidence in who your God is? In Romans 8, Paul asks us a very important question which addresses how God leads and guides our lives by his providential hand. He asks, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword?" The answer he gives is a hard no. The troubles and the sorrows of life will never be able to separate us from the love of our Savior. Paul says that in all these things, we're more than conquerors through him who loved us. And so, beloved, when we're confronted with illness and disease, with accidents, with economic hardship, with relationship difficulties, with stress, anxiety, depression, even death, these things may raise serious questions about God's care for us. While we may know God works all things for our good, it's still tough to undergo the adversities of life. But let's remember Paul's words at the end of Romans 8. He writes, "For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels or rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." May that assurance of God's constant and abiding love help us move forward through the struggles of life as the Lord leads us to our eternal home. Amen. In response to the gospel message, let's rise and sing Psalm 77, stanzas 4, 5, and 7.